Thursday, July 11th. This is the Hermetic Hour. I'm your host, Punk Runyon, and tonight we review the new book, Gateways Through Stone and Circle by Frater Ashen Shasan. And we will have the author as a featured call-in guest. This book is, in our opinion, the best practical how-to-do-it book on the traditional Western ceremonial magic tradition in the past 16 years. And it is also one of the best why-to-do-it books also. This is a magical book by a real magician who has studied, lived, and mastered the art. And after working his way through the Lamegaton Scotia and Almadel, he decided to concentrate on Trithemius's Book of Secret Things, or The Art of Drawing Spirits into Crystals, from Francis Barrett's The Magus, and make this system of angelic crystal conjuration his special forte. He built his own equipment. He graphically detailed this in the book, and he described all the technical details, rituals, and techniques necessary to replicate his experiments. And the text is beautifully written in a mature, sophisticated, and very readable style. So, as we said in the announcement, tune in Thursday and we'll visit with the Magus from the Magus. Now, this book is one of a very, very few. And there's lots of books on magic. And I mean magic with a K, M-A-G-I-C-K, lots of them. You can go into a big occult bookstore and shelves are full of them. But unfortunately, most of them are written by what you would call researchers or armchair magicians. They write books about how it was done, and how they think it ought to be done, and how they think it may have been done, and whatever, but there are very few people who have actually devoted years and years of actual work in the system, in the various systems, and have actually done the work, and have done it successfully, and will write a book introducing you to it and giving you specific practical instructions on exactly how to do it, describing the equipment, the sigils, the graphics, the whole business. There are very, very few books like this. And the reason, of course, why is because, quite frankly, not very many people, even though we like to think there are a number of people that do and whatever, but this is still a very verified art. And so, but there are a lot of people who are interested in it. I mean, people love to read these books about magic, and even if they don't ever have any intention of actually doing it. And knowing this, I think a lot of people figure they can write a book about magic, and even though they don't know how to do it themselves, and they can write a book about magic and get away with it, because most of the people that buy magic books really are not going to go and actually try to do it. Now, that said, let me kind of describe a little more about what this book is going to do for you if you actually intend to be a ceremonial magician. This is a particular system, and it's what you would call a rather basic. It's thaumaturgy, but with a very theurgic quality to it. In other words, this is angel magic. It's Trithemius, of course, was Cornelius Agrippa's guru and his mentor. And Trithemius was, of course, one of the famous, he's Trithemius is the one who put the all the scattered elements of medieval ceremonial magic together, sorted them out, and he and Agrippa, working together, put together the system. Pretty much, it came down to Francis Barrett, who did a condensation of it in his book *The Magus*, which came out in about 1801. And so Trithemius's Book of Secret Things and the Art of Drawing Spirits into Crystals is definitely angelic. And he's dealing with planetary angels. He's dealing with angels that are holy angels on the side of the light, on the side of the good, but very, very definitely very powerful spirits. And so that's the nature of this particular system. And also, this system uses, and those of you who have seen the Magus and know exactly what I'm talking about, and we've even shown it to some of our videos, it uses what we call the Trithemius Tower, but that's what it is a frame. It's a frame that can either be metal or wood, in which you set a crystal and then surround it with a gold bezel. And so the crystal's in this frame, and you put candles on either side of it. And this is, of course, a system which is primarily good for an individual practitioner. It doesn't work too well with a group, but it for an individual practitioner, it's very, very good. And or for an individual practitioner who is using a scryer. And this is basically Frater Ashen Chustin has done. He's perfected a system, and he is affiliated with a group of people who have pretty much done the same thing. They work individually or with their partners, and so this book of his is now primarily for the person who wants to do this work individually, or perhaps with their partner or whatever. There's a lot of people, well, I hope there are a lot of people who would actually want to do that. And this way you don't have to join a lodge, and you don't have to all sit around an altar and channel spirits together like we sometimes, well, we often do. And so this book is very, very valuable for the person who wants to do this in the privacy of their own abode and with just perhaps their husband or wife with them, working with them. This is absolutely ideal for that. And also, this book is transcendental. It's not, there's no black magic involved at all, and there shouldn't be, especially if you are going to work, by yourself or just with your partner. Black magic of we don't like to call it black magic. Let's say. Anything that smacks of the demonic should be avoided anyway if you're going to work in this area. So, and yet, I know by experience, and all of us do, that I've worked in, that angels coming to you in crystals are tremendously powerful. Just this is actually, once you become a practicing magician, you find that your most powerful experiences are from angels that you're manifesting through crystals, either the Almadel system, the group Almadel system that we developed, this system that Ashen Chasson has based on the Magus. These are the most powerful experiences. They're more powerful than your dark mirror experiences, as as fascinating as they may be. But this is where the power is, and this is where the wisdom is, where you're going to. I think one of the Shemi Hum for Archangels once told me that he said that the Goetic spirits are the knowledge and the art, but the angels are the wisdom and the power, and that's the way he put it. And this is what you're going to get. And Maestro, are you there?
I am here.
Oh, well, welcome aboard. Came in at just the right time, and I was just mentioning, as you probably heard, that you and I both agree that calling down the angels into the crystal is more powerful and a more rewarding experience than calling up the other critters in a mirror. and so from there, will you tell us how you got started in this and give us kind of a background history on it and how did you get going?
Well, I started in ceremonial magic, a lot of, like other magicians, where I heard about the Goetia, actually, and I was interested in the Goetia. I came across her work and some of the other works, and a lot has happened since then, but I came from a background, my family and myself, where spiritual encounters were fairly frequent. There was a lot of unusual things already going on, so it was kind of a happening in my life since an early age, and I wanted to explore this deeper. On one point, I was fascinated by the paranormal world, and on the other hand, I wanted to get a measure of control and understanding where it feel like I could protect myself and others if needed be, or feel safer, at least felt like I had more of an understanding, more of a hold on what these various beings were about and what was going on. And what happened is I began learning to scry and reading various books and trying to get a handle on these, some say psychic experience, but magical experiences, viewing spirits through dark mirrors and crystals and this type of thing. And I began with modified forms of Goetic magic and ceremonial ritual, and then I started getting in more depth, really wanting to practice and see if I could reproduce magical experiences and experiments just like they were written about in the grimoires, in these books, without changing anything, without jumping to more modern conclusions, just do the banishing ritual on this and then do this, and if you can't see the spirit, oh, they're there, but, you know, act like it's there anyways. I really wanted to see if this stuff could be accomplished like it's written about in the grimoire. So that's kind of how I came about it. And dealing with the angels, I had done invocations and various magical rituals with the archangels. I'd become very practice in the banishing rituals and the other rituals like opening by watchtower and the golden dawn, and I memorized some of those very serious, but I kept seeking, and honestly, I didn't quite get the experience that I've always wanted, that I was always looking for, until I practiced the Almadel system of magic that is found in the Lemegaton, book 4 of 5. And I made the wax tablets each. I did it in the correct time and with the invocation. And for some reason, I went about it, which I was just going to do it, and I didn't have any preconceptions, but I was just determined to follow it as closely as possible. And I was fasting, and I was going about this in the most spiritual and direct way that I could. And during when I started with the Eastern Almadel, and I finally, the room changed, the light changed, there were just little sparks of light in the air, the smells of fragrances like flowers, and you know, and this face appeared, and then I heard a voice. I saw the angel, and when it really, really appeared to me in that kind of setting, and I had my first solid conversation where I knew there was no imagination in it. It was just this being was there, this angel was there, and it was not just visuals, not just auditory, but my whole being that is filled with this presence of something holy, something spiritual, something so powerful and right. I think tears were streaming down my face. It was this experience that it captured each one of my senses and also went past to things that are hard to explain, where I was able to come in contact with these angels, and I was like, finally, this is what I've been looking for. This is what this is about. And those were my first initial, I guess you could say, successes and veritable experiences working through a grimoire tradition. And the Almadel is how I got started into it before I came to the drawing spirits in the crystal system, which I wrote about.
Well, the Almadel, of course, is a very, very powerful system. And, you probably recall that we built one and had it on top of course, of our double cube altar and showed it in the Magic of Solomon video. And that wax, even though, you know, we figured out a way to sort of translate it into a group experience by using the double cube and putting those horns on it, there's something about that wax with the ball and the luminous wax. It was just really, really wonderful. I remember, and I can understand. I can really understand how you would be. That would be your first real breakthrough. Would be the Almadel. But you made different Almadels in different colors, right?
Yes, according to the the Lemegaton and everything. Each core, each altitude. Which I learned, it doesn't necessarily explain that, but what I learned working through it is they're very elementally orientated. The white one goes in the east, the red one goes in the south, there's a greenish silvery one that goes in the west, and there's a black greenish one that goes in the north. And at first, I didn't want to make any presumptions, but I was like, well, I learned in the Golden Dawn, and I'm used to the elements being in this direction, but is that really what this old grimoire meant and everything, and I didn't want to jump to that, but it just turned out to be that way. The angels were very specified to their directions, and they were different than just elementals, but they are angels that correspond to these archetypical, symbols of the elements they represent. I mean, the one in the west, the angel, notably a little bit more feminine, and it dealt a lot with, you know, what my emotions were doing and how to overcome some of the issues there. The one in the south and the red was all about, my passion and well-being, able to put your energy into turn. So I could really recognize the kind of correspondence that they had with the elements. And I was thinking that might be, but I didn't really understand how much to each degree they were about that until I got through the second or third working. And I did this operation just about every single Sunday for over a year. And I worked with them during their time, and I only worked with the proper Almadel during their season and time, just like it suggests. And it was really interesting because I think I did a couple experiments where I wanted to talk to them one more time, ask them one more thing, but the time had changed out of their season, and it didn't work very well, and I was kind of surprised how strictly, I guess, either the angel, maybe it was in me, but the angels seemed to kind of correspond to their time, and when you were able to call them up and hold the best conversations with them. I was only really successful during kind of the midst of their time, during their core time, and it was just a fascinating experience.
And now you say that you have, you're talking about having conversations with them. Now, I know from reading your book that you've had you're actually a hypnotherapist. And if you, when you do this, when you say you have an angel fully contacted, and does the angel, can the angel, in your experience, use your voice to speak aloud through your voice, or does the angel present whatever the angel is going to say as a sort of a very explicit knowing in your mind? And now, can you explain that aspect?
How does that work? I've never acted as a scryer, as a second in ritual. These, all of the Al-Medel operations, I was the only one in the circle. So I guess I could repeat what they were saying to me, but when they're speaking to me, and people have asked me this before, well, you know, do you hear them? Are the impressions in your mind? And it's very curious, because I tried to narrow it down, because one thing I did realize, and I would write about my experiences, I journaled everything right after I'd had the experience, is that the angels do, they have different voices. Like I could tell them apart. I knew it wasn't just like, you know, one being and everything. They, you know, even the personalities and the things that they would tell me were different, but the way they sounded was different, but the communication, because I was in the moment, but when I would go back and reflect, I'm like, you know, what did it sound like? Was there an echo in the room and everything else? And I was like, no. And the way I could, where I tried to explain it is, it felt like there was no distance, even though they were, you know, some feet in front of me or whatever, probably only a couple feet,
Let me ask you this.
Go ahead.
Now, does this voice, when you hear their voices, does it sound like they're talking to you from somewhere in the room, or are you aware that they are, that this is the as realistic as the voice is, it's a mental kind of a, yeah, it's a transmission. How would you describe
right,
that?
Right, and that's what I was trying to get at, is that I don't know, like, I don't know if I could have picked up anything if there was, like, a recorder in the room, but it didn't feel like there was any different, like, these felt like there were a lot, most of them were speaking, like, directly into my ear, that it wasn't, like, somewhere off in the room or, you know, some location in the room that I could pin down and be like, oh, they're in this corner. I mean, I was looking right at them, but their voice was like almost like they were talking directly into my ear. Like there was no interference or no way for me to kind of get a depth of perception of exactly where that voice was coming from. And also their communication is interesting, because they do speak in words and they can do that, but their language and their communication is much more sophisticated, because simultaneously a lot of times they would speak to me in words and stuff that I would understand, but I would also get feelings that distinct from my own, and I would also be able to see things in my head. And one of my best memories is I asked one of them, you know, well, how did magicians before used to conjure you? How did this Al-Medel system used to work before? And it was interesting. I heard what they were saying, but it's almost like it was secondary, because they gave me a very sharp impression of this Middle Eastern looking man of a long time ago, and he was kneeling and praying, and I could hear him like I was watching almost like a movie, because he was praying and candles, and the Al-Medel looked very different. I think it was even made of metal or something like that, but I could tell that's what it was, and I could see this smoke rising, and I was watching like this other magician. Like, they were able to show me, I guess, an image of long ago or something, of this magician conjuring, doing this Al-Medel system, and I felt kind of what he was feeling, and it was like this whole experience. So instead of just like telling me with words, they did that, but showed me and gave me these impressions and this kind of empathy all at the same time, where this message was conveyed in this huge picture. And it was like, wow, okay, I really understand, kind of, even though I didn't know this person way long ago, I kind of felt where he was coming from and what was going on. It was really, really fascinating.
And then, of course, they're communicating in biblical style prose, the these and the thous and the thou shalt, and that rather than in contemporary idiom. Right?
Yeah, that is true. It wasn't like Shakespearean. It was, I could understand, but there wasn't any modern slang or anything like that. It definitely wasn't talking to another person, in our culture and time. It was understandable, and it was clear. It wasn't like too classical, but I guess it was formal in that way. And I don't, to be honest, I don't remember these and thous and everything, but it was just very,
well, now,
very
diplomatic. When you use a scryer, does the scryer use her or his voice like a medium in a seance? In other words, the spirit takes over the voice of the scryer, and you could, and does that happen, or do you have to, or does the scryer tell you what he or she is experiencing, or
right,
just wait to?
Right,
yeah.
I haven't had my scryer. He never acts as a medium. You know, if I, during the rituals and everything, if I ask him a question, what's going on, he's basically like a translator. That the being says this and does this. He's still speaking as a translator, not as the spirit. So there's no mediumship there necessarily. He's just kind of relaying back what's being told to him. And that's how it goes.
Yeah. As you probably know, if you use this mediumistic sort of quality, the operator can carry on a conversation with the receiver, the scryer, and the spirit, both at the same time, and it depends on who he addresses. The scryers are not acting as in a mediumistic sense then. Well, in a way,
right.
I guess they are though. Yeah, they are in one sense. Yeah. You find out using this, I described it before you came on, your Trithemius framed crystal. I think that's probably about the best way to describe it. It's a crystal in a solid frame. And this means that if you have a scryer, then the scryer is sitting directly in front of the crystal. And then are you on a stool right behind the scryer, or how do you work that?
I have them, when they sit down, I have a stool. Like if I'm not doing the operation myself, and all of the first operations were all done just by myself. There's no one else there. They were all my own experiences. But when I started working with the scryer, they sat in the seat, which is directly in front of the crystal and right next to the edge of the circle, and I just stand behind them. I stand the entire time during the operation and work from there. And I don't get in front of them. I don't, walk anywhere where they're gazing. I just stay in the background and work and speak from there.
Well, we used to do that too, but we're getting old, and so for the past several years, we all sit down. We've all been sitting down. It's so much more comfortable that way.
I'm sure if I do that long, I will be too.
Yeah, you. Oh, well, I'm not that old. Come on, Pat. No, but anyway, no, but this is, yeah, I used to stand, I used to stand up and go on and on for an hour and a half. No, it's much better to sit. But now, you're working planetary angels with us. I think many of us listening have a copy of one or another version, facsimile version or whatever, of Barrett's Magus. Now, went from the Galatia. You did the Almadel before you did the Galatia, right? Or did you just start off with the Galatia?
I attempted a few evocations with the Galatia first before I ever worked with the Almadel. And the biggest difference was, like, I had some success, I guess you could say. I mean, something happened that was interesting. It kept my passion to learn it further. But then, you know, it was kind of a modified form in my results where I'm like, yeah, there's got to be more to this, even though I saw something in the triangle. But the Almadel was near the beginning. I'd done some work before then. I'd done some even traditional Goetic work, but the Almadel was, you know, kind of the breakthrough when I started doing traditional. And then afterwards, when I did my Goetic operations, it was like night and day. I mean, it was huge. It kind of went from the sensations of, I guess, trying to experience the open road of magic was, you can compare it to riding on a bus and having somebody else drive, and then driving a motorcycle by yourself at top speed afterwards. So it's quite a big difference.
Yeah, I agree on that completely. Now, one of the things, though, that you and I both agree on, there are a lot of things we agree on, and not too many we don't agree on, but one thing that we certainly agree on is, if you're going to do this kind of work, if you're going to do it, you have to have respect for the higher powers you have to have respect. What was it? You quoted it, and I've quoted it, everybody's quoted it, that fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. I have to admit that when I started off, with Galatia, I thought I was a Thelemite. I really did, and that was not. I kind of got out of that because there isn't. You don't have the protection. This magic that you and I have been doing is a balanced system, and it has to be a balanced system, and you have to have respect for God, and you have to get God on your side. Otherwise, you're wallowing around in a bunch of very rebellious, and no matter how nice they might be, some of them might be, but the spirits of the Galatians are all rebellious. They all of them will get you in some kind of trouble if you let them. And
right.
Yeah, they will. And so consequently, you need that higher regulating power, the power of God and the angels. And this is something that I think I mentioned to you on the phone the other day and gave that talk over at in Austin to that Thelemic group, and they were one of the masters over there, Lodge Masters. He told me about this guy they had that was trying to do all the Galatia spirits and ended up, well, in a pretty bad way, and I told him, I said, you gotta have a balanced system. You can't. The angels are have to be on your side, and so even though we're Hermetic, we certainly have a great deal of respect for the traditional Judeo-Christian God forms. And we use them in slightly different ways, but still they're the same. Now, tell us all kind of a little bit about where you're at on that,
sure.
What your thoughts are on that?
Sure. Pretty much anything spiritual, anything magical, when I get to practice, it comes from experience. That's the big thing with me. I've got to experience it for myself. There's other magicians, other people that, you know, they have their different philosophical views and everything. That's fine. But for me, growing up during the before, during, and, you know, so on and so forth with my experience, I have come to really appreciate the assistance that I've received from a lot of my magical attempts where I did something, or I know I did something incorrectly. Something could have gone seriously wrong. And during the times, the biggest thing where I choose to practice and go about magical ritual the way I do is that The assistant has been there when I've needed help, not just in a magical sense, but just in my life when things have not gone wrong. I've received that assistance, and I have gotten those presents when I've asked for it. Every single time, I've never been let down. That is the biggest thing. And everybody experiences difficulties and things go wrong, but like my holy guardian angel and these other positive spirits that I've asked for during times where I did not feel very, very powerful, where I made mistakes and things have gone pretty wrong most of the time for my own fault, that they've been there. They've come when I've needed them, and that's the biggest thing. I mean, I don't get too dogmatic or religious, but you know, and I can't count myself as like you know, strong Christian follower or anything else, but I have the respect for that energy, for that positive creative force and those angels, because, you know, I have received that assistance and that acknowledgement and that ultimate proof that they're there and have worked me through things when I definitely feel like I didn't deserve it. I know I didn't deserve it, but they did it anyways. Even with I was working with the Al Medal and everything, I would ask, you know, for this help or that help, and, you know, they would tell me the work to do, and I didn't even complete it. I didn't honor it completely, and I got sidetracked doing other things, and I go to my next evocation feeling very small, and, like, I don't think they're going to show up. I am completely not doing what I'm supposed to do, and I would do the evocation. They would come anyways, and that holy feeling would fill the room and fill me, and it would be the most amazing experience in the world. And I was so surprised, because I was like, I didn't believe in myself. I didn't think this was going to work. I didn't feel like I deserved it, but they came anyways. And this is the kind of thing that this deserves respect. And I'm like, I work with all manner of beings, not just the angels, but the goetics and nature spirits and everything. But I get the pretty straight that I feel like the gifts that I've been given, it's not under my own steam. It's not because I'm some powerful magus or I can do things other people can't do. No, it's because for whatever reason, I've been allowed to be able to experience this. I don't know why. I don't think I deserve it, but it's there. So I can't do anything but honor that. I've been like, hey, I've got to do good, whatever I can conceive of as being good and whatever way I can share this. This has been given to me. This is the experience I have. It's not because somebody told me to believe this or I feel like I'm going to be damned if I don't. It's because these are the gifts and these are the experiences I've had. And that's all I can do is wish to give back or to honor that. And that's the best way I can explain it.
Well, that certainly is a beautiful explanation. And that leads me to discuss something with you that we've been working on improving or standardizing lately, and that's the Holy Guardian Angel operation. And I understand that in talking with you, you said that you did your retreat out in the wilderness for 9 days. That's very impressive. You want to tell us about that?
Sure, I'd be happy to. I'm actually, I've never spoken about previously or written about, but since the book, and there's another publication coming out soon where I've got a section in it, and I think it's called Walking with the Angel, and there's a bunch of other magicians that are sharing their piece as well. But I decided to share it, and basically, since a young age and before I even knew what I was doing, I was kind of adventurous and would want to, I kind of go hardcore with whatever I decide to do. And the first, I read the sacred, you know, book of Aberbell and the Mage, and I know that, I guess there's a few magicians that have done like the full operation. I was never able to do that, and never did the months and months and months of, you know, leading up to this operation. But I like the idea where it talked about having a secluded space out in the forest, and I've always loved the forest. My teen years were spent where I was lucky, and there was forests all around my house, and I was always spending time out there, so a lot of mystical and magical experiences happen out there for me anyway. So I like the idea of having this oratory and this magical space where you would fast and have communion, knowledge, and conversation of this holy guardian angel, this one being. Because I always sense there's something guiding me, and like before I even had more knowledge of it, I knew there's something there that's helping me and leading me towards this magical path and doing these types of doing this type of work and these things. So it was a number of years ago, and I was able to schedule out the time, and I started fasting and preparing, and I read in my temple ahead of time. I didn't have the whole enclosure and everything. It was kind of modified. I just built this circle out in this forest grove and made a little altar, and I had my candles and everything. And I go into more detail in the book, but I guess what I'll say here so I don't go into the complete thing is that I went out there with these expectations and excitement and fasting and really determined with this hard will. And I must say that I've come to acknowledge that a lot of mystics and a lot of the masters of before really undergo this kind of dying and the destruction of the ego, because I went through a dark time, went through hell. I went out there where nothing magical and mystical happened. I was out there in the woods. I'd spent time out there before, but I was kind of exposed and I was hungry. I didn't feel strong enough to defend off any animals that might come around. I was weak. Nothing was happening. I wasn't getting any revelations. I was getting upset. I was angry. I was glad nobody was hopefully filming me, because it was during probably about one of the lowest points of my life. My behavior and just a lot of my ugliness came out, and I didn't think anything was going to happen, and I was frustrated and angry, and it was kind of this relief. And then through these days would pass by, and they started blending together, and I think I was almost going a little bit crazy. There's nobody else around, and I was getting a little bit delusional, probably from this fasting and also from the emotional discharge that I was doing. I don't know, on the fifth day, it was right in the midst of it. And what happened is that there was a release, some sort of switch change right during that final day where I was supposed to invoke my angel and do this prayer in the ceremony that I barely remembered by that time. I was so out of it. But I came to this point where my ego is gone. My expectations, even thoughts of magic or anything else, all that stuff is kind of gone. What I thought I was, and, I don't know, kind of dreams, I guess, from being this kind of amazing magician or whatever. It was just kind of a stripping of all of this stuff that I had built up, I guess, about myself and my life, about everything, and I just let it all go. I remember coming up to that point where I invoked my angel, but my mind was such where I was completely let go of my pride or things, so I was not nervous if it didn't work. I didn't have any thoughts at all. It was just gone. I just went through it, and there's this kind of stepping over point of the most incredible, a most amazing experience that I will never be able to completely describe in my life, but it must be similar to what some people experience as this enlightenment, the Zen of a dissolving of myself or what I thought of myself, and this kind of joining with perfection, with this ultimate perfection and this spirit, which I kind of hope was there, but I never knew until that point. I never knew existed and that there was a God, there was this actual, some sort of divine structure, creation, that kind of thing.
You had what Walter Stace would call a mystical experience, classic mystical experience. Would you describe it as undifferentiated unity with God?
Yes, definitely during that point there was no, I guess it was just I felt myself reintegrating into totality, into the pattern of life. There was no difference, and it was you know, dissolving whatever thought was my will and my destiny, whatever you want to call it. And it was just, there was just the is. And, you know, there was, it went beyond it where I definitely came in contact with my higher genius. But it was so funny how completely different it was anything that I had built up in my mind of what I thought it might be or what it was about, anything. And it was so amazing, but so simple, so ridiculously simple. It was just, you know, it was perfect in that it was not complex. It was not, you know, something grandiose that I guess I could imagine. Like I said, it was just almost remembering my perfect place in the universe.
You are the center of the universe, and you know everything, but it doesn't really matter whether you do or not.
Exactly.
Right?
That's a great way to put it.
Yeah.
We just said.
Yeah,
it's like
well,
you know everything, but there's no questions. There's no, if God was right there and everything, but I had no worries, no questions, and nothing to ask.
That's right.
I didn't need to.
Well, this is a most precious experience, and gosh, you know, my feeling about that, must probably your feeling too, is I'm not particularly, I don't feel particularly smug about having experienced it. I just feel like I've got something precious that I really wish other people could have. Is that just kind of the same feeling you have?
It is. There's definitely nothing smug about it. I mean, and that's why it's weird to talk about, because I guess I can almost remember, because I went into it with smugness, like, wow, if I can achieve this, you know, I'll be connected to my angel, and a lot of people won't go through it. It's a weird kind of ego thing, and I think that's really what that death is about, where people, I think that you think it's your will, if you want to even talk about the dilemma and everything, but it's not. That's conscious stuff that you build up, that it's got to die. You got to let go of that, or you'll never really understand what that will and what the universe is about. And it's definitely nothing. There's no ego in it. And I think one way or another, everybody returns to that point eventually. You can't take any of this crap with you, and I think some people just are able to experience that, and then, you know, you come back, and I guess it's just a reminder for me, and then my angel constantly reminder, because we go through life and we built up this junk in our minds and these arguments and these battles with people or this or that, and, you know, whatever happens, and I go back to that point, and it's like, this is crap, and this is not powerful.
Yeah.
What am I doing? This has nothing to do with reality and what this is about. So it's if anything, it's the absence of ego where I got to tear myself back down again.
What you're describing, of course, as for those listeners who haven't had it yet or experienced it yet, is the classical mystical experience. This is that it isn't where classical mystical experience is not where something well, it can be. I suppose it can be where an angel that looks just like a human being, but with a glow on, walks up and says, "Hi, I'm the angel Susie L, and I'm here to tell you the secrets of the ancients." That's really not quite often. I don't know, maybe that happens to some people, but it didn't happen to me, and it sounds like it didn't happen to you, and yet really, what we're talking about is the classical. This is the classic mystical experience. But, however, did you get a name? Do you have a name for your HGA? I don't want to hear it, but, I mean, do you have a name so you can get a hold of him or her whenever you need to?
Good. Yes, and it's an interesting, in my experience, I got a name and a definite impression. There was definitely this direct bond, and I even got image. It was this complete inexplainable experience, but there was a definite unique presence that identified itself as, you know, this is what I am, and this is what connection is, and the communication is interesting. I mean, people ask if, you know, I haven't conjured, you know, them into a crystal or anything like that. My, you know, when I want to feel that connection and everything, it's more of a kind of soul travel, astral kind of reach. A lot of times, even though I'm sure if need be, there could be more of I could ask it to come down in more of a physical presence during a ritual setting. I just I've chosen not so far to do it that way, but I don't think it's difficult to do at all. But it's the level of assistance and communication is really amazing, and it really depends on just what level I want to connect on and for what purpose. But for, you know, evocation, anything magical, especially after that, has just been incredible. And I find it humorous a lot of times, because a lot of the things, like my book, like I didn't even intend to write a book, making the implements and everything, I didn't have any previous knowledge about how to do that. I mean, I did some research, but I found it humorous, because a lot of things fell into place. They clicked, they worked, I figured it out, the ritual came together, I was able to do it in due time, to spend most of my time practicing, and it was just, it worked like magic, and I found it humorous, because I could feel the assistance and really recognize
your liber spiritum is, and I do envy you, your liber spiritum. I need a description of how you made it, and how you put it together, and the illustrations and all in the book are just, I mean, they're just, it makes me want to go and redo mine. I think mine's pretty nice, but then on the other hand, you really did it right. I mean, your liber spiritum is just beautiful. It's a work of art, which, by the way, brings up a point that I want to ask you, because this is something that, you know, we're talking about different types of spirit signatures. And, you know, if you go through Barton's second book and see all those squiggles he has in there, it looks to me like these are signatures that he gave the spirit his hand and let them go ahead and put their signature in his liber spiritum. That's what it looks like to me. But then again, on the other hand, you're taking, it's perfectly okay to do that in a notebook on the side, as you have described. And then, of course, once you get that signature, you can copy it into the vellum on this liber spiritum. Does this all sound like what you're doing here, or am I off track? Let's talk about
during. During my initial experience, when I was using the liber spiritum, and I wanted to, it was my first attempt at actually making, I wanted to see if I could make one of these authentically and see if they worked kind of like they were described, is I would conjure these angels, and I would have the book placed before them, and I would actually do this outside the circle. I kept my scrying device for the drawing spirits and the crystals experiment, it's directly right outside the crystal, and there's a place for it, but I put the book in front of them, and I ask if they will imprint that, and if they will agree to have their, you know, energy bound to this page, and to make it basically like a catalyst for conjuring them and asking their presence to immediately, you know, appear. And I actually got some early instruction about, okay, well, you know, if you want to do this, it's supposed to work this way, and you have to be very, very careful, you know, with this, because if you use it the wrong way, or if you're just flipping through it or doing this, we're going to take, the energy is going to be gone from it. It doesn't work that way. You can't have it bound and connected to us in this way, and this, you know, very strict methods of using this is applied. And I was like, okay. And I would introduce the signature of them, and they would imprint this kind of really neat, it would appear on the paper. It's kind of difficult to explain, but I would ask for a similar sigil, something unique to them, And it appears it's on the book after the ritual is done. I don't show it to anybody else, but maybe it was an astral thing that they allowed me to see it on the page. I mean, who knows? But it looked like it was on the
page.
They allowed
you to see it on the page, and you can trace. Wait. You know, you see it on the page, and then you trace it, right?
That's correct. Yeah, I would take my ink and
good.
Back
good.
Over
that's
it.
What when, that's what
right.
I'm trying
and
to
I would
get
rather,
at.
I would draw the image to the best of my ability, and my artistic skills were so-so. I'd rather draw their pictures. And afterwards, it was, and I think I wrote about it in the book as well, it was interesting that, I was working in my book and constantly doing this work, and before I made these sleeves for the actual angelic page with their image and their symbols on it, I'd accidentally, sometimes it would flip to that, and boom, I mean, immediately, it made my head spin. I was like, oh my God, and I had this complete sensation and something being there, and it was like immediate, and it was made me kind of woozy and everything, and I was like, whoa, okay, this is serious, because a lot of times after my incredible experiences, I'd get back into my normal life, and it's like, I know they're there, but you almost forget just how that the stuff is still going on, even though you're not in the midst of ritual and not thinking about it or anything. I mean, it's there. So I had to be very, very cautious with my book of spirits.
Maestro, we're running out of time here, and we want to sell you some books. And so consequently, let's concentrate on that right now, the little bit of time we have left.
Okay.
The book we've been talking about tonight is Gateways Through Stone and Circle. And you can get this nice $50 beautiful hardback from Amazon. Now, you have a deluxe edition, I understand, with a quarter bound and goatskin. And that we have to get from Nephilim Press, right?
That's correct. Uh-huh.
Okay,
yeah, directly
so Nephilim Press
for my publisher.
Yeah, Google Nephilim Press for the deluxe quarter bound goatskin edition. But the one, the beautiful book I have here has a beautiful silver sigil on the cover, and it's just a really nice production. And that's on Amazon. Can you give us a website and all where we can go to?
Yes, to order the book directly from my publisher, the best thing to do is to go to www.nephilimpress.com, and that's going to have my book on there, and it's probably the easiest way to purchase a copy. Also have some other great books from some excellent magicians that I've come to know and have corresponded with as well. So that is the place to go. And if anybody's interested in my work.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm gonna have to let you go. Gosh, it's been fascinating and wonderful, and I really can't recommend this book highly enough. And thanks again, and good magic. Take care and good magic. Next week. Well, from crystals, we're going to go to dark mirrors, and I'm going to tell you everything you need to know about how to use the dark mirrors, how they were used, everything else. So next week, dark mirrors. We're going from the light to I don't know what they call it, the darkness or not, but let's just say we're balancing it out. Next week, dark mirrors. So in the meantime, good magic.